Hello, everybody, and it's nice to talk to you. My name is Mark McCurry. I'm the ecology manager in Bordnamona, and I'm going to be talking about bogs in Kildare, obviously focusing on the Bordnamona bogs and talking about why they're so important. Obviously, this is all about this is for Kildare County Council, and it's for this great initiative, Kildare Climate and Energy Week. So we're really, you know, trying to shine a light on climate action and what we need to do to respond to the climate emergency. So I'm just going to talk about just a few different things, you know, talking about why bogs are important, why re-wetting is so important for climate action and Bordnamona bogs. I'm going to talk about some of our Bordnamona bogs in County Kildare and their biodiversity. I'm also going to talk a little bit about the Peatland Climate Action Scheme. This is this great new rehabilitation project that I'm working on. And lastly, I'm going to talk about the cutaway and integrating other land uses onto the cutaway. I'm talking about where Bordnamona are going from here. So why is peatland so important for the carbon cycle? Well, you know, there's all this talk about bogs, and bogs are fantastic for storing carbon, and they are. And, you know, some scientists, you know, around the world, they have looked at the amount of, you know, carbon in different habitats and the amount of carbon in our environment. And what they found is that peatlands contain about 25 to 33% of the global soil organic carbon. So that's, you know, nearly a third of the world's soil carbon, but they only cover about 3 to 6% of the land surface. So obviously there's a lot of carbon stored in a relatively small area. So peatlands store more carbon than any other ecosystem, terrestrial ecosystem. And we can see this from the graph, this graph here on the right. If you just look at the black bars, you know, that's comparing the below ground biomass or carbon in the Amazon rainforest to what the average is in the peatlands. And you can see that the average below ground carbon in peatlands is nearly five times greater than in the Amazon rainforest. So just highlighting, bogs and peatlands are a really important store for carbon. So because they're such a good store for carbon, they are really important in relation to climate action, because unfortunately, if they're degraded, we release that carbon. And this slide really shows the complex dynamics and fluxes of the release of carbon from these peatlands and how carbon is taken in. And what's really interesting is in a bog or a peatland which is in good condition and which has water level close to the surface, and we can see this in the top diagram, the bog is releasing some methane, but it's taking in carbon dioxide, and the sphagnum moss is really important for taking in that carbon dioxide. And, you know, in a good peatland that's in good condition, this is considered peat forming, and that's how this peat builds up. The sphagnum dies off and the other plants die off. They don't completely degrade, obviously. The plants are developed into peat, and that carbon is stored in the bog when the water levels are close to the surface. Unfortunately, if we do drain that peatland or use it for fuel or whatever it is, that peatland starts to release carbon, and it's really the residual peat. If it's dry, it's going to be releasing carbon dioxide to the atmosphere. And it's also releasing carbon through the water into the wider catchments. And once vegetation develops again, it can also release more methane. So that these dynamics are really complicated and really important to understand in relation to rewetting and climate change. And this is you know what it's all about. This is what we want, and this is a picture of sphagnum moss. And And this is a really good indicator of a bog or a peatland that's in good condition. And if there's a lot of sphagnum moss, we are pretty happy to say that that's an active habitat. It's taken in carbon dioxide from the atmosphere, and it is potentially peat forming. So it's really all about the sphagnum moss, which is considered a ecosystem engineer in peatlands. But for sphagnum moss to grow, it needs persistent high water levels. So it needs water levels close to the bog surface. And this is really the starting point for a lot of our bogs in County Kildare. This is raised bog. And obviously, we don't have many examples of pristine raised bogs left in County Kildare because of all the impacts from Bordenmona, from turf cutting, and from other land uses that have affected our bogs now. But just to paint the picture about what rewetting is about and what we do. This is just an example of blocking drains. And obviously in our drain bogs, the water level is quite far down and below the surface of the peat. What we do is we come along, we block the drain, we block the drain with peat dams. You can see that through the this sequence here. And then by blocking the drain, you're raising the water levels up close to the surface of the peat and rewetting the bog. And what this means is it really aids the natural development of sphagnum-rich plant communities and peatland habitat function. So we're restoring that peatland habitat function. So it's this rewetting process is vitally important for bog restoration. Obviously, Bordenmona has had a very significant impact on a certain proportion of these bogs, particularly in Kildare, through decades of peat extraction. And in some of our bogs, the majority of peat has been completely cut away. So we have bogs in lots of different conditions with different levels of residual peat. But the key thing is that we have a really heterogeneous environment. It's quite variable. So we have different starting conditions for our cutaway peatlands and different rehabilitation approaches because of these bogs and peatlands that are in different conditions. Just to talk about that for a little bit, some of our bog still has relatively deep peat. And if it has relatively deep peat, if we can get the hydrology right, we think it will grow sphagnum. And this is an example of where this happens spontaneously in County Kildare, in Timo North Bog. And again, it's really indicator that if you get the conditions right, the sphagnum moss will grow again. And the key thing is here, we want soggy conditions with water levels close to the peat surface. And in time, like this doesn't happen overnight, in 10, 20, 30 years, we get sphagnum-rich vegetation, which is a sink for greenhouse gases. But obviously, we have a lot of bogs that are in a different condition. This is a wetland, and we have different targets for these bogs. So again, the target is creation of soggy conditions with emergent vegetation, but this vegetation will be more like fen and reed bed. It won't be raised bog anytime soon. And that's just because the conditions have changed so much and the water chemistry is now influenced by the underlying calcareous substrates. So here's just a few examples of rehabilitation in some of our Kildare bogs. Again, here's an example at Lullymore and the rewetting here, and you can see the bog cotton starting to develop. You can see the heather in the foreground. Again, we've worked closely with Lullymore Heritage and Discovery Centre, and they've done a fantastic job here of working on this piece of cutaway and really developing it for amenity use. Here's another example at Lodge Bordenmona Bog, where we rewetted a section adjacent to the high bog at Lodge that is now managed by the IPCC and created a wetland to try to indirectly support the raised bog remnant at Lodge IPC Bog. And again, the focus of rewetting, obviously, that's very important for climate action and for keeping the carbon in the ground, and also setting these bogs on a trajectory towards becoming naturally functioning ecosystems again. But it's really important for biodiversity as well. And we have a wide range of different species on our bogs, or on our colorway bogs. What's interesting is, like, a lot of these species here are species that prefer calcareous habitats, and obviously bogs are acidic. And this just is an indication of the fact that the environment has changed and the underlying subsoil is now much more important in as an influence. And so we get these species like pyramidal orchid or bee orchid, for example, and we get fantastic insects like the common blue butterfly, which again, you know, feeds on bird's food, which is in the top right-hand corner. And again, this is a species that likes calcareous soils. We have other species like round-leaf wintergreen and sausage. These are scarce species, but we're finding them with more regularity in our Kildare bogs. And this is a really interesting species for me. This is basil thyme. And again, this is a rare and protected species, and we find it on some of our rail tracks in County Kildare. And again, it's not a bog species, it's a species of eskers, but it seems to like the rail tracks, because sure, they were built from material excavated from some of the eskers around the Midlands. And just to mention, what's really exciting for us in the Midlands is the appearance of the common crane. And again, this is the first time this species has bred in our bogs in 300 years. And it looks like it's been coming to this particular border Mona bog for 3 years now. This is really exciting, and it's really exciting to see such an iconic species like the common crane coming back to our bogs. And it's just a real indication that rewetting can really support biodiversity like this, and can really encourage these unintended consequences almost of these new species recolonizing in Ireland. And again, you know, obviously Bord na Mona have ceased peat extraction. We announced the end of industrial peat extraction at the start of this year. That was due to a whole range of different factors. But obviously the company is now transitioning, and it's looking forward and looking to decarbonize and support the government in its climate action strategy. And that means developing renewable energy. And we've already seen renewable energy development in some of our bogs. And this is an example at Mount Lucas. And Bord na Mona hopes and expects to develop more renewable energy across its bogs, and including those bogs in County Kildare. But what we can see here is the footprint of that renewable energy is about 3 to 4%, but it's only covers a small amount of the actual area. And it means that there's a lot of cutaway still available for rewetting, and still available for biodiversity and so on. So our approach, our strategy is really to develop and integrate these land uses and try to develop these win-wins for climate action. Obviously, the renewable energy is going to reduce carbon emissions, and we want to re-wet the bogs as best we can so that we can create these win-wins for climate action. And look, we would be aware this does mean there will be some trade-offs, but hopefully overall there would be a wide range of positive benefits. And the other aspect of developing bogs in this way is it means you can incorporate other land use, such as amenity and so on. And just to finish on the climate action scheme, the Peatland Climate Action Scheme, obviously this is in response to the cessation of peat extraction. Bord na Mona are embarking on a really ambitious peatland rewetting scheme, and this is targeting 33,000 hectares over the next 4 years. This is just an example of one of these bogs in Umhurst. This is near Monasterevin, and you can see Lots of drain blocking, lots of cell bonding here. And again, the target here is to try to optimize hydrological conditions, bringing the water close to the peat surface and keeping it as wet as we can, creating these soggy conditions again. And then through natural colonization, we will develop that skin back on the bog. And hopefully this will reduce the carbon emissions and set that site on a trajectory to redevelop naturally functioning peatland ecosystem. And just a few more pictures of what this looks like on the ground. Again, you can see lots of drain blocking by excavators and lots of bonding and so on. And, you know, just to finish off, this is really important. This is going to support a lot of different national strategies, from the Climate Action Plan to the National Biodiversity Action Plan. Really important for our rivers as well, in terms of improving water quality and in relation to water attenuation. So thank you very much.
Brilliant. Thanks so much, Mark. I always love that combination, the comparison between the rainforest and then the boglands as well. It's just it's incredible to see also the common cranes and the bee orchids. So just a few quick questions. You have touched on some of the answers already. But just to kick off, if the first question here is in relation to rewetting of the bogs, will this have any impact on adjoining landowners? Or can you speak a bit more on that?
Sure. We're obviously very sensitive to our adjacent landowners and people in the area around these bogs. We're not working in isolation here. So the majority of our works will be in the middle of the bog. And we have said that we won't block any of the boundary drains. Okay, so what that means is we're focusing on rewetting our own property, but we're mindful that we have to take into account the surrounding environment. So the way we've done that is we have employed a team of hydrologists from RPS to do drainage management plans and to really assess all of our rehabilitation plans, to assess the impacts of our rehabilitation. And take, for example, we have different bogs in different variable topographies. In some of these instances, water may have to flow into one of our bogs from upstream adjacent land. And if that happens, like, we're not going to block those drains to back up that water. Again, we have to compromise and be practical here in terms of what we can do. So again, it's looking for the best case scenario here and looking to rewet our bogs as best as possible, optimizing the conditions, but mindful that we are working in an environment where there may be adjacent land uses where those areas can't be rewetted indirectly.
Fantastic. On relation to, you mentioned about pristine bogs, I'm just wondering, what are the key species indicators? I know you spoke about sphagnum, to make a bog pristine.
Yeah, well, sphagnum is a really important ecosystem engineer, and that we want to see it in any of our bogs where we have deep residual peats or where the conditions are a bit more acidic. So it's really good to see sphagnum redeveloping in our bogs again, because it means it's heading on that right trajectory. And where we get sphagnum, we'll see these carpets of bog cotton, and in time you'll see the other raised bog species colonizing. For example, like, if we have a bog where there's a lot of heather, like, unfortunately that's an indicator that bog is probably a bit dry, because heather likes dry conditions, and unfortunately that would be an indicator that it is still leaking greenhouse gases to the atmosphere. And in time, like, once we get the skin back on these bogs that were bare peat, we see a lot of other biodiversity starting to colonize. And like at some of our bogs, we've seen lapwing, for example, starting to breed very quickly on our bogs. And that's really great to see. And obviously you see loads of insects like dragonflies and so on. But unfortunately, Not all species come back, and we know there are some species that are like curlew and red grouse that, you know, aren't, you know, we don't really have red grouse in County Kildare anymore, and unfortunately curlew numbers are very poor in terms of breeding curlew. And unfortunately, like while we may be able to rehabilitate our bogs, that's not going to support these other species. They're going to need more help if the objective is to bring them back onto our bogs.
Fantastic. And I just have one final question. So it was in relation to the wind farms. You spoke, of course, there's going to be some trade-offs with the wind farms and peatlands being located beside and within one another. But I was just wondering, is there any co-benefits that people might not have heard of from them being conjoined together, such as recreation or maybe something that people don't know of?
Yeah, well, like a really good example of this strategy is Mount Lucas Wind Farm. And like I would encourage anyone who's interested to get out and visit Mount Lucas. Again, as I've said, the footprint of the infrastructure, it's only about 4% of the overall site. A lot of that site is quite diverse. It has a range of habitats from birch woodland to wetland areas, and there is a lot of biodiversity on that site. And for a lot of species, the wind farm construction doesn't really have that great an impact. Obviously, we know that wind farms do have impacts on particular bird species, and we have to be mindful of that as well. And the way to minimise those impacts is through good planning and design in relation to trying to reduce impacts on, for example, whipperswans. But like if you go to Mount Lucas during the summertime, it's fantastic for orchids, for example. And I've counted seven different species of orchids in the old gravel pit in Mount Lucas, and they've all just colonized naturally. And so it's a real indication of the value and the opportunity here of this cutaway habitat. And by integrating other land uses, it means that those sites are continually managed, and hopefully we can continue to derive different benefits from these lands. Obviously, there's the industrial benefit, the benefit of renewable energy, but also deriving these other ecosystem service benefits of the value of the biodiversity, the value of being able to get out and enjoy that amenity in terms of being able to walk in these nice wild areas, and the other ecosystem benefits of keeping that the residual carbon in the ground in terms of the residual peat, and hopefully in time encouraging the development of potential carbon sinks again.
Hi everyone, my name is Fiona Doolan from Teagasc, and I'm going to talk to you today about grassland ecosystems. In June of last year, the CSO told us we had about 4.5 million hectares of farmed land in Ireland, and the vast majority of this was dedicated to grassland. So that's grazing for our livestock, or silage and hay for winter fodder for our livestock. In addition, we'd over 470,000 hectares of rough grazing, so extensively farmed mountainous areas. We're very familiar with the pictures you see at the top of your screen about some of the fantastic livestock and food generated from these grasslands, but oftentimes we forget about some of the other things that these grasslands provide us with. Grasslands are very good at providing us with a lot of different services. As I said, the one we're familiar with are the forages that are produced for livestock. And in turn, that provides us with the fantastic quality food that we're so familiar with in this country. But secondly, there's the huge area of biodiversity that's supported by these grasslands. So think of our native flora and fauna, how valuable these habitats are in supporting all this wildlife. I suppose another thing we sometimes take for granted in the country is our agricultural heritage. Think of our rolling green hills, our 40 shades of green, the image that we portray to the world, and look at the tourism and recreation that's provided for all of us through that. But our grasslands are also of major importance when we talk about our pollinators, our pollination playgrounds that ensure we have our wide variety of species, this genetic diversity that's supported in these areas. Grasslands are also really, really good though at providing us with an area for water retention when you think about high rainfall and flooding situations, but also they act as filters for to filter our waters, our rainfalls, and improve our water quality. And where would our environment be? Think about our air quality, our carbon storage, our carbon sequestration, if we didn't have the ecosystems provided by these fantastic grasslands. So isn't it brilliant to think that our grasslands don't just provide us with one benefit? They provide multiple benefits at every turn to our habitats, our flora and fauna, our biodiversity, our pollinators, our livestock forages, supporting our traditional breeds, supporting our air quality, our water quality, all about multiple benefits from the one area. Our extensive grassland, as I said, is a hugely important habitat for our natural flora and fauna. So we're not just talking here about our wildflowers in the meadows, but think about our bumblebees, our honeybees, our flying insects, our macroinvertebrates. Think about the mammals that we are so proud to have. Think about the hares and, you know, even our ground nest and birds like our meadow pipit. These are all species that we want to take care of. We want to ensure that they have a habitat that they can thrive in. And our grasslands are such a place for that to happen. Many of you, like myself, will have very happy memories playing as children in hay fields in those endlessly long summers. But those hay meadows, perhaps they also offered another ecosystem benefit for children during the summer holidays. However, one of the major things that they do provide is this huge variety of grassland species. So just because the field is green doesn't mean that it's all the one type of grass. As you look across your screen, you'll see many common grasses out there today to be found in our meadows. Coxfoot, rough meadow grass, sweet vernal, Yorkshire fog, each with their own uniqueness. And that uniqueness, I suppose, builds into resilience. Resilience in our meadows for to be able to handle different growing conditions, different weather patterns, say, for example, drought or heavy rainfall. And that diversity there is of huge benefit when we think about the many different species of insects that are out there. So there's something for everybody once we can keep that variety there. But our traditional hay meadows haven't arrived there by accident. And they won't stay there by accident either. It takes a conscious decision by farmers in charge of these meadows to ensure that they stay there. So in particular, what I'm talking about is the choice of mowing dates. So delaying the mowing of these meadows until after the grasses have headed out or the seeds come out and dispersed, in order to keep that variety of species there. And that's not easy to do in a country like Ireland, where we have such difficult weather patterns. And it can be quite risky to depend on something like traditional hay meadows, given our weather patterns, for your fodder supply for next winter. That effort by those farmers needs to be acknowledged by all of us if we want to see these hay meadows stay in place. I suppose the other side of our grassland swards are our grazing swards. So swards that we're keeping for grazing our livestock during the summer months. And in terms of species-rich or extensive grassland, it's important to remember that these fields are farmed areas and they do need to be farmed. They must be managed. They didn't just happen or occur there. They happened because they have been managed in such a way by farmers, and that continued appropriate management needs to continue if we want to keep the species variety in place. And I suppose that just a word of caution in that these species-rich grassland need to be valued, but they also need to be rewarded, or the farmer to be rewarded in order to keep them there, because these will not be the most productive areas of the farm when it comes to livestock production. That doesn't mean that they're not very productive in other ways when we look at our ecosystems and the habitats they provide. You know, there's such a variety and such of a colour to be seen in some of these swards at particular times of the year. Again, you need to know maybe when to look and what to look for. For example, if you go out today to some of these fields, you will see very little. Being the middle of the winter, we won't see any of these beautiful flowers like on the yellow flag or flagger or scabious plants. They will all have been there during the summer. So it's sometimes it's very important to know what to look for, but to know when to look for it as well. I'm sure some of you will be very familiar with plants like meadowsweet or self-heal. You'll probably be able to identify them easily. And again, maybe be familiar with how they were used in the past, how their medicinal qualities was well known and used by people many, many years ago. These are commonly found in our extensive grassland fields. Quite interesting to take a walk through these grassland fields, May, June, July time of the year, to see how many of these you actually can identify. Extensively farmed grasslands. So grasslands with low stocking rates and little to no nutrient or fertiliser input, managed extensively. You will see plants like vetches or vetchlings, watermint, bedstraw will be quite commonly there. As I said earlier, these grasslands, even though they're lowly stocked and not terribly productive in terms of livestock, they can be extremely productive when we look at the variety of flora and fauna that they can support. And they do need to be managed. They do need to be farmed, because one of the greatest threats to our extensive grassland is abandonment, where no activity is carried out. That is not a benefit when it comes to ensuring these plants stay in place. We do need to see those grassland fields managed and farmed, but managed and farmed appropriately for the level of plant and diversity that's there. Orchids can be beautiful in meadows, particularly in the early summer, and are really a positive indicator of a really good variety and diversity of species that are there, and are quite striking and easily to identify too if you do see them. So well worth keeping an eye out for those. Just a word about our improved and intensive grasslands. Just because some grassland areas are quite productive when it comes to output in agricultural terms, doesn't mean they don't have something to offer from biodiversity point of view. And one of the greatest areas that we'll see this along is along our field margins. So traditionally in Ireland, we're very lucky to have such a network of hedgerows and trees around our fields. And the margins along these are where we can see some really fascinating biodiversity, some really great levels of plants that we might not see further out in the field. So those field margins are extremely important corridors for our wildlife in terms of shelter and protection and food. That's where an awful amount of the activity will happen with our birds and with our small mammals. So our field margins are really, really important in those fields. So even intensively farmed grassland fields have room for biodiversity. The field on your left-hand side is pretty intensively farmed, but as you look a bit closer, you'll see that the area shown on the top right of your screen has been fenced off and really left for to do its own thing. So while there's grassland in there, there's also a selection of grasses, of weeds, of wildflowers and of funguses. So as I say, even intensively farmed areas, there's always room for an area dedicated to wildlife. So I suppose when you see what's possible and see the variety of wildflowers that our grasslands can and do support, you really begin to appreciate what they can offer us and what sometimes we don't really realise that they do provide for us. So Irish grassland, yeah, there's plenty of grass, but it is much, much more than that as well. Thank you. So how do we enrich our lawns for biodiversity? Well, the answer is kind of similar to how we enrich our fields for biodiversity. In the first instance, it's to retain what we have. Don't go looking for new features or to do something new. Maybe just focus on what's there already and allow it to do its own thing. So minimal intervention. Leave it as it is. Let the grass grow. Let the weeds grow. Let the flowers grow. Let them flower and allow them to reseed themselves. That way you're allowing whatever's naturally there to continue to be there, and you're allowing those seeds to reset and germinate for another year. So really minimal intervention, eliminate mowing or at least delay it until after that flowering period and allow it to regenerate again for other years. How can animal production and biodiversity of grasslands be aligned? Well, as I said earlier, all fields will need some level of management, but it's appropriate management for what you're trying to do. So if those areas are extensively farmed areas, it's to really keep your stocking rates low on those areas, to reduce the amount of fertilizer or keep it to a minimum, do not reseed it or plough it, allow the features to be maintained as they are. And if that's not possible on all the farm, or indeed, you know, if some people are farming intensively, there are always areas within the farm that can be left for biodiversity. So maybe there are areas that are more difficult to farm, less productive lands, corners of fields, areas close to watercourses, close to natural woodlands, areas that are surrounded by hedgerows or groves of trees. They're all areas that we could leave a small area aside for biodiversity and continue to farm away as we want on the other lands. So the answer is yes, the two can be aligned. If the farm is looked at in a holistic way, both can be successful and can run side by side. How to select grass mixes when seeding. So if a farmer is going to reseed and plant new seeds in the field, there are things he can look at in order to ensure that there is a bit of a mix there or a bit of biodiversity. One of the areas that's becoming really popular at the minute is the idea of multi-species swards. So rather than just having a perennial ryegrass sward, introducing other species into the reseed. So for example, chicory, plantain, clovers, lucernes. What we now have is a productive sward, but a more diverse sward. So again, a sward that's resilient and that can handle different conditions. What's both above the ground and below the ground now have different characteristics and not just a monoculture. So it's well worth considering when reseeding that multi-species swards may suit and be able to tick a lot of boxes. How do we choose areas to leave uncut, or how do we create enriched habitats? Well, as I said earlier, sometimes it's about retaining what we have and enhancing it rather than looking at new areas. But if we are now looking at new areas, it's best to look how they fit into the overall picture. So rather than choosing an area that's completely separate to other diverse habitats, look at areas on the farm close to those woodlands or hedgerows, wetlands, marshlands, close to ponds, or close to groves of trees, where there's already a population of flora and fauna, and where you're now adding to what they have. So you're creating corridors and creating areas that wildlife can pass through with protection, with shelter, with food. So you're augmenting what's already there, as opposed to starting something completely fresh in a completely different area.
Hi, my name is Cormac McCarthy and I work in the Environment and Heritage section of Waterways Ireland, and we're delighted to be invited to speak today as part of the Kildare Climate and Energy Week. The focus of today's talk is going to be about the canal heritage through Kildare. So we're going to talk about ecosystems, the ecosystem services, the threats to that biodiversity, and what we can do collectively to ensure that the canals are preserved for this and future generations. So Kildare is very fortunate to have, in fact, the Grand Canal Barrow Line and the Royal Canal going through parts of the county. And the canal system is, as we all know, an artificial system. So it was man-made back in the 18th century, but it has a diverse ecosystem with a myriad of habitats contained therein. As such, they have been designated as proposed natural heritage areas under the Wildlife Act. And now we're going to talk about just some of those habitats that you will find within the canal environment. So as I said, it's the canal corridor. So it's not only a continuous ecological corridor going from Dublin the whole way to the Shannon, but it's quite narrow. So what we have is we have a long ecosystem, but in terms of the width from side to side, it's bounded by the hedgerows, so quite narrow. That doesn't mean though that there is a significant amount of diversity there. So for example, we're going to look at a habitat map that we developed for the Grand Canal Barrow Line. You'll see it here on screen now. And that looks at the section between Ballyteague, the 21st lock, to Glenery Bridge at the 22nd lock. So not a huge distance, but you might be surprised to know that within that short distance, there are 23 different habitat types that contain over 178 plant species. So that's actually the second highest diversity of plants that we have on the Grand Canal Barrow Line. 42 bird species were recorded, a number of mammals, such as otter, badger, fox, as well as butterflies and other invertebrates. So as you can see, though man-made, over the centuries, the canals have evolved into incredibly diverse ecosystems. And so it's great to have this rich heritage asset within Kildare, and all of these habitat maps that you see on screen and the reports that were developed to support that and to support our maintenance works and capital works are freely accessible if you go on to the Waterways Ireland website, www.waterwaysireland.org. So now we're going to talk about the ecosystem services that the canal system provides to the people of Kildare and nationally. So there's quite a few. There's four different ecosystem services that the canal provides. You have the provisioning service. So there are fish, there is clean water, there is pollination. All of these activities happen along the canal. There's a regulating element to it. They store carbon by the very nature of the trees and the hedgerows growing along the canal bank. Significantly, in some sections of Offaly and in Kildare, we own peatland adjacent to the canal environment, and they're also excellent at storing carbon. Culturally, as you know, Waterways Ireland is a recreational authority, so the recreational potential of the canals is huge. So we have people walking, cycling, angling, boating. So that recreational value is incredibly important. But also culturally, there's the well-being associated with it. It's the fact that people go to the canal for, you know, mindfulness and just to, I suppose, get away from everyday life. And it's an incredibly relaxing and therapeutic space to be in. And then finally, it's supporting environment. There's the biodiversity, there's the soil formation, there's photosynthesis. So as you can see, again, going back to the fact that these are artificial man-made systems, that does not take away from the fact that they are hugely important in terms of habitat, ecosystem, biodiversity, and those ecosystem services that they provide free to us, the users of the inland waterways. In terms of threats to our canal systems in Ireland, I suppose a number of the key issues that we would be very concerned about is the first one would be invasive species. And after habitat loss, that is one of the key areas that is affecting our native biodiversity. So unfortunately, we would have to deal with on a regular basis a number of invasive species and how these impact our local biodiversity. So for example, two plant species, terrestrial plant species, would be Japanese knotweed and Himalayan balsam. And what happens in those situations is they totally take over sections of canal bank to the point where no other biodiversity will be supported. Winter heliotrope would be another example. So again, a lot of these were introduced as botanical species, some of them hundreds of years ago, but now when they've been released into the natural environment, they just have an absolutely devastating impact to the point where when they die back, a lot of the time you can have sections of bare exposed bank, which when our river systems is incredibly difficult in terms of erosion and the loss of soil and bank stability. So it is absolutely incredibly important that we are very mindful of invasive species and particularly as well how they can spread. So when people are out using our waterways, we have a clean and inspect clean and dry policy where you will, before you leave the waterway or before you even arrive in the waterway in the first instance, say for example, if you have a boat, what you should do is there any water on the boat that can be drained out and the boat left to dry? Because that can contain species like zebra mussel. Is there plant fragments in the propeller? If you're an angler, are you carrying any soil or plant matter on your kit or your wellies? And the same for walkers. So as well as Waterways Ireland being mindful of that as we move our plant and machinery from one navigation to another, it's also we're asking for the help and support of our stakeholders to also ensure that we don't accidentally transfer invasive species from one section to another. The other area would be water quality. And again, as artificial ecosystems, we are entirely reliant on other natural water courses to feed our canal systems. So in the situation of the Grand Canal and the Barrow Line, Pollardstown Fen is one of our main supply feeders, as well as a number of streams along the length. On the Royal Canal, it would be Loch Oole, just outside Mullingar. Again, we're incredibly fortunate. Pollardstown Fen and Loch Oole have pristine water quality. But what we do find through part of our water quality monitoring protocol, that there are feeder systems, smaller rivers and streams that historically have fed the canal that may be suffering from increased nutrient loading, which in a canal environment can have a devastating impact. Because unlike a river system, which can naturally flush itself clean, in a canal environment, the water is pretty much standing still. So if you have a pollution event and it comes into the canal, it can have a devastating impact because it will just reside there in the water in that particular area. This can lead to fish kills. It can result in degraded habitat for plants and invertebrates. So it's something that we take very, very seriously and monitor on an ongoing basis. The other thing, and I suppose this is a global issue as well as the biodiversity crisis, is climate change. And this is something that we're happy to advise. We are just in the last couple of days have put our Waterways Ireland Climate Action Plan out for a public consultation. And we are very mindful of the impacts that this can have to our canal systems and to all our waterways. And you'll see a diagram here now beside me, which just gives a very brief overview of what can happen. So for example, in the event of increased rainfall, we could have sections of peat embankment, which become saturated and unstable. We could have highly erosive flows in our river navigations, like the Barrow, and the impacts that that can have in terms of bank stability. Equally, if we had long periods of drought, we will have reduced water levels, which means that boats won't be able to navigate, that there will be reduced water levels, which could impact fish populations. Again, so we're looking for that optimal, I suppose, temperate zone where Ireland is located, that we would just get that adequate amount of rainfall to ensure that our waterways are adequately supplied with water. Again, if we get increased high temperature events, that's a really big issue for our staff who are working out in the waterways, and we need to be very mindful that they are safe and we're providing a safe working environment for them. But equally, increased temperature for long durations will impact the towpaths, roadways. So really, it is incumbent upon all of us, and there is a direction from government that the public sector, such as Waterways Ireland and Kildare County Council, lead by example in the area of climate action. So that is why we were delighted to be one of the first organisations to have developed their climate action plan, which again, we would really love to invite comment on. And you can, again, you can see that on the public consultation section of the Waterways Ireland website. So please take a look. All our contact details are there, and we would love to engage with you, the public, to see not only what can Waterways Ireland do in terms of climate action, but how can we work together to ensure that our waterways are preserved for this and future generations. So in terms of a call to action, I suppose our first thing is, as Waterways Ireland, we are custodians of the inland waterways. We are preserving and protecting them for future generations. However, we do know that we really need to engage with our stakeholders and our community partners to ensure that this is done in a holistic and sustainable way going forward. It's very much a shared heritage. We have a lot of different users. We have recreation users, we have wildlife enthusiasts, we have business owners. So I think there is very much, there's a shared vision that we protect the waterways and its biodiversity. And that is really about working together. So my call to action is, let's work together to protect this biodiversity resource. Waterways Ireland is charged with the management and maintenance, and we will continue to do that in the most sustainable way possible, protecting both the heritage and the biodiversity along the canals in Kildare and all the waterways under our remit. But there are things that the general public can do. Waterways Ireland are a core member of Leave No Trace. I would strongly advocate that as a community group, you sign up to the Leave No Trace and its 7 principles, and that can be done by accessing the Leave No Trace website. And then the other thing is, we have a community grant scheme, and just some of the examples of projects that we have supported. And again, this is very much support in terms of money, but also advice being at the end of the phone, that there are groups such as the Baltrasna Boreen Biodiversity Group, which we have developed a wonderful citizen science project with on the Royal Canal, just outside Mullingar. There is the Irish Midlands Ringing Group, who do wonderful work every year in terms of ringing birds, particularly swans, is a lot of the work we've engaged with them in around the Dublin and Kildare area. And then the last one would be the Irish Wildlife Trust, who had a form of Train the Trainer event, where they brought out community groups to the inland waterways and the canals here in Kildare. And they, I suppose, they instilled a knowledge and an appreciation and techniques of how to monitor biodiversity. And that, I think that's hugely important, that community groups are animated and encouraged to do work and then to share that information. Knowledge sharing is incredibly important. So for those of you working in the areas of biodiversity and recording, please, you know, feel free to get in contact with us, access our ecological reports on our website. But importantly, make sure to share that knowledge through the likes of the National Biodiversity Data Centre and the recording options they give you in terms of the biodiversity maps and the species records. That's as important for our native biodiversity to see how that is doing, but also for the likes of invasive species. So now we're going to discuss some of the things we can do to protect and enhance the biodiversity along the canal network. And this not only applies to Kildare, but to all our waterways throughout the island of Ireland. So as we've just discussed, we have our climate action plan, which is looking at the protection of the waterways heritage resource in a long-term tenure manner. This also aligns with legislation, the Paris Agreement, and our obligations to reduce our emissions and improve our energy efficiency by 2030 and to become ultimately climate neutral by 2050. The other strategic approach that we adopt to protect biodiversity along the canals is through our heritage plan. So the first Waterways Ireland Heritage Plan from 2016 to 2020 just came to an end. And what we're doing now is we are aligning our heritage plan with climate action plan. So we're going to have 2 10-year strategic documents. And I think that's incredibly important that you have, that corporate strategies like this speak to each other, that heritage is mindful of climate action and vice versa. I suppose the other thing is, there are 2 crises happening at the moment. We have the biodiversity crisis, and we have the climate change crisis. However, we need to be very careful that in our rush to protect, to stop climate change, where there is a huge emphasis on things like planting trees, that we don't do it on sites that have other intrinsic biodiversity value. So we need to protect our calcareous grasslands, our fens, our peatlands, and that we look at this in a very holistic way in terms of protecting biodiversity, but also ensuring that we make our inland waterways climate resilient. And then I think a key part of this, and today is an excellent example of that, is how we undertake projects through a spirit of collaboration and engagement. So Kildare County Council today is running this fantastic event. They've invited us to speak. I know Bord na Mona are there. And there's also this understanding that we will all work together to try and find solutions and knowledge here. There is no point in Waterways Ireland developing a solution that is very good in terms of protecting biodiversity or climate action and not sharing that knowledge, not only with our state agency partners, but with the commercial sector, the private sector, and the general public. So that is something we are wholly committed to in Waterways Ireland as part of our heritage plan and our climate action plan. And yes, I think that that's going to be a key aspect of how we protect and enhance the biodiversity resource, not only along the canals and waterways, but across the island of Ireland. Once again, a huge thank you to Kildare County Council for inviting us to speak today and to be part of the Kildare Climate and Energy Week. My contact details are here on screen. We would love to hear from you on all issues, heritage, biodiversity, climate action. So make sure to get in touch, and I hope you enjoy the rest of the week and the events that are planned. So we have some questions in on the presentation, and we're just going to go through them now. And the first one is, what are the main issues of concern for waterways that the public can assist with to help biodiversity and increase climate action? I suppose to deal with the biodiversity issue first, one, we would love to work with community groups throughout the canal network, and we do a lot at the moment in terms of pollinator plan projects, citizen science projects that we're running on the Royal Canal in Mullingar. So we're always looking to partner with community groups, and we'd love to hear their ideas about how they can improve biodiversity locally. In terms of gardens and green spaces and community areas adjacent the canals, a great area for guidance and support is pollinators.ie, which is the All-Ireland Pollinator Plan. For climate action, this is going to be an area that Waterways Ireland are going to be working very closely on over the next few years. As indicated earlier, our draft climate action plan is currently out for public consultation. So please, we would love to get community feedback on that. There is going to be a dedicated community webinar. We'd encourage you to partake in that also. But again, if you have a project that can be based locally that you feel can positively impact climate change, please do get in contact, because a lot of it will be sourcing communities and projects to run pilots on and then see can we scale them up at a later date. The next question, what plants or animals would show that a water system is healthy or in trouble? So Waterways Ireland is charged by the EPA to undertake monitoring of the canals on an annual basis. So we invest a considerable amount of resources into monitoring water quality, invertebrates, and plant life along the canals. Now there's no quick answer on this. It's a complicated matrix of looking at the invasive species that may be present, but then importantly, the native insects, plants, and water chemistry. Unlike natural lakes and river systems, which are required to reach good ecological status, because the canals are artificial, there is a different threshold, and we're obliged to meet the criteria of good ecological potential. And again, all that information is freely accessible and publicly available, and it's all submitted to the Environmental Protection Agency, who do their reports on water quality in Ireland. Are there an invasive species like terrapins that have been released and are thriving in the canals? The answer, yes. Thriving, no. We have one particular terrapin on the Royal Canal, which seems to get reported several times annually. No one has yet caught him, but unfortunately, terrapins and a lot of similar creatures which were bought as pets and then no longer wanted were put into inland waterways. It's not a good idea. Ideally, your first step should be if you're going to purchase the pet in the first instance, but you never know how a species that isn't native to Ireland is going to react when it goes into the wild. On one hand, it could kill the creature because it could be too cold or mightn't be suitable. There could be predators. But then on the flip side, you could be releasing plant matter like, for example, Elodea and other species which were brought into the country to oxygenate ponds. But once they got into the natural environment, just wreaked havoc in terms of native biodiversity. So never, ever dispose of plant or animal matter into our waterways. Why are canals dredged and the effect on ecosystems of the canal bed? Again, what we're back to here is we're back to the fact that the canals are artificial ecosystems. So if a canal was left unmanaged, it would over time sit up and change from open water habitat into fen marsh. And we've seen this in some of the no longer used canals around the country, like the Irina Canal down in Clare, like the Longford Branch. So if you don't do sustainable and appropriate management of a canal network, you will in fact lose habitat diversity over time, to the point where it'll become unsustainable for fish populations, and it will evolve into an entirely different ecosystem. So at the moment, Waterways Ireland manage the canals very carefully. Dredging is an integral component of that, not just to allow for recreation activities such as boating, kayaking and angling, but also to ensure that we maintain the biodiversity value of the canals. So yes, dredging is an integral part of that management programme.